My working hours are probably sort of 9:30 till 6:30, and then filming days can be really long. So getting into work at kind of 6:30 or something, sometimes to pick up a car, going out on location and coming back at 10:30, 11:00 at night.
During the filming period, you're usually working around double your contracted hours in a week.
Just recently, I was producing films for a very fast turnaround magazine programme, and I was working very unpredictable, very, very long hours. And often I didn't have any notice of that. It could be the day before I'm due to film, I suddenly find out I'm doing a 16-hour day, and then a day which I thought might be in the office, I might have to go and film some extra material. I was easily doing 60 hours a week.
I don't get UPA, and I think it's interesting that News, for instance, would get that, because it's acknowledged that working long and unpredictable hours is part of the job. But here in London Factual, in production, working more than your contracted hours is still part of the job, but we don't get UPA.
I don't actually particularly feel like I should be paid unpredictability allowance, insofar as I think of my job as something that is unpredictable and that will have very elastic hours, but having a wage that perhaps, in terms of where it's pegged annually, recognises the fact that on occasions your working hours are very long, i.e. a higher wage that takes that into account, would be absolutely fine.
If there is a payment to be made for working unpredictable hours, then I deserve it, because I do unpredictable hours. And rather ironically, I used to work in radio sport, and I got UPA there, and I did work in a rota system, but actually I knew what my hours were going to be a month in advance. So actually, if anything, it was the least predictable job I'd actually done, and yet I was getting paid UPA for it. So there doesn't seem to be any rhyme or reason to how UPA gets paid.
It's not really clear what you need to do to be promoted. You just kind of have to know the right people, shout louder. There's not a clear structure of kind of key skills. It would be nice if there were clear sort of job description level. So when you've made a certain number of films, or if you can self-shoot and self-edit, then you get a sort of credit to your next level or something like that.
I have no idea when I'd get a permanent promotion. I have no idea what the timescales are. I know that it would involve doing the job for a long time that I would seek to get promoted into, which has always struck me as a sort of reverse promotion, or a promotion after the fact. So you finally get paid for what you've been doing for a long time, but I have no idea what actually triggers that promotion.
Promotion at the BBC is a real mystery. I think it is based, for me anyway, it's based on potluck. I think if you know the right people, you mix in the right circles, then I think you've got a better chance of moving up.
Looking around the department at people who are getting the acting opportunities and getting paid for it, it tends to be, if you have a senior manager directly supporting you. If you don't have that, then there's just no way you're going to get promoted at the moment.
It hasn't always been made particularly clear to me what I need to achieve to move up to the next level. I've had the odd couple of chats with production managers, production coordinators, but nothing particularly formal. It's always very informal. If you can get more involved with A, then it might lead to B.
If you develop new skills, you'd think that would get you promoted, but actually here it seems that the more skills you've got, the more you're going to stay in your current job, because you can prove that you're multifunctional. Why would they pay you more money? You can edit, you can film, you can direct. What's the point in promoting you? You might as well just stay where you are and just become a workhorse for the department.
In recent years, I've been told on more than one occasion, off the record more than on, that the best way to get promoted is to leave and go to the Indies, get called what you are, and then come back in the next grade, which is pretty shocking advice, which is pretty shocking that that's how it should be, really.
I've just had my appraisal this year. I've just submitted it online. I've got no idea, outside my appraisal manager, who reads it, how that's documented, and how my objectives that I have or haven't met are monitored, and by who. So I've got no idea what the appraisal process means. All I suspect is that if it comes to redundancies and deciding who will be made redundant, that my appraisals will get looked at.
I think the appraisal system is next to useless, but I don't think that's the fault of anyone in particular. I think it's the product of the, I suppose, systemic weirdnesses in the way employment works at the BBC, i.e. we have so many freelancers, we have, you know, commissioners who effectively decide what our workload is, so the people who are appraising us don't really have that much control over the work going ahead and the work in the past. So, well, I think people make a good effort on appraisals. I think they can't really work in the system of employment that we have here because it's so fragmented and so short term.
I think the appraisal system is completely irrelevant. It shouldn't be, it is. I had an appraisal with a senior manager this year who couldn't help me go forward in my career. Had nothing to say other than, yes, you were really good. We'd like you to come back and work here again. Here's the middle of a road grade for you, because that's all I have to say. I've never once seen anything in my appraisal actually feed into career development at all, and it just seems to be me deciding what I want to do in the next year and trying to do it with very little support.
I found it quite good in that the main time I have a chat with my exec is through the appraisal. I don't know how useful it is, but I suppose it does focus your mind as to what you're doing and what you can do for the next year.
The appraisal is not a bad point to sort of stop and have a think about what you've done in the last year. It makes you realise how much you have achieved, and can help you think about what you do want to do next. But normally everyone's so busy working on what they're working on that they don't have time to put into practice what they've said they'll do, because we just career around from one production to the next with little time to think in between time, and it's hard to get the training in that you say you want to do because you're always on production and that's always flat out because we're always understaffed.
For me, the appraisals are an annual chat with a manager who I barely see any other time, who I haven't worked for in several years. If anything, it seems a bit of an inconvenience. The best thing I can say about it is that when I do actually have that chat, I do get a bit of feedback on how I've been doing, and it kind of makes me wish I could have that chat once a month.
I don't think that the grading and pay systems are clear, for starters, so I don't think that they're transparent. I know you can't know what everyone else is being paid, but it's never been made explicit to me why I'm being paid the amount that I am. So in that case, I would say that the system is not fair, because I don't understand it.
It would be better if everyone was paid for the job that they do rather than the job that they are called by HR, given that everyone's sort of unofficially acting up the whole time. You know, the jobs that we do inside are equivalent of at least one job or two jobs above what you'd be called if you worked in the Indies or outside the BBC.
I think for me the grades are effectively just a set of numbers, and that's about it. The meaning behind them is lost on me, and I think it's lost on quite a few people I've spoken to. You're a grade 8, you're a grade 7, you're a grade 5. What does that really mean? Someone that's at the top end of grade 5 could be earning more than somebody who's in the middle of grade 7.
In production, we work on a project by project basis, and on a given project, you could be the AP. On another project, you might be the producer. On another project, you might be the camera person, or you might be the editor. And the fact that the official grading system can't acknowledge that, and therefore can't shift in the way that you're having to shift all the time, is frustrating.
What would change about a pay and grading structure is either more parity with people who are coming in on freelance and fixed term contracts in terms of what we get paid, or, you know, proper incentives for having that less pay but being rewarded with things like, you know, clear career progression path, you know, being in-house and part of the BBC, feeling like you're a preferred person to be working on projects.
I think in terms of overhauling the system, I think it has to be a drastic overhaul, but I think just changing the grading and it not having an effect on people's pay will actually really annoy people, because it will just look like lip service. You know, you could call me a producer, but if I'm still on the same pay, what good is that to me? And it will just make me look better in front of my friends, but it's not going to look better in my bank balance.